So, today we are going to talk about the third chapter itself, human reproduction. In this topic, till yesterday we have completed what is male reproductive system anatomy, what are the parts present in the female reproductive system, including the adjacent glands which are producing the milk, that is mammary glands, and we also will discuss today about the gametes, the structures of gametes in the male reproductive system and female reproductive system. Male reproductive system and female reproductive system. So, in this, the male gamete, sperm, draw the diagram along with me, the male gamete sperm. So here we are seeing the structure of a male gamete sperm. So sperm is a microscopic in nature. This is microscopic. Generally, we can see the sperm only under the microscope. And from per type per human organism, male produces approximately 200 to 300 million number of sperms. So they will be producing approximately 200 to 300 million number of cells per time. And if you see the sperm is having three different parts. Each sperm, when you observe under the microscope, the sperm is divided into three important parts: head region, head region, middle piece, that is neck region or middle piece region, the tail region is meant for swimming or giving the motility to the cell. So sperms are motile. Sperms are motile, that is, they have the movement in their cell body. And when you are seeing the sperm is, as we have discussed, that it is divided into three important categories: head region, middle region, middle piece region, tail region, from here to here. And generally, the head region, when we see the head region of the sperm, the head region consists of first upper part, penetrating part called as acrosome. This is a cap-like structure. And it consists of enzymes or hormones responsible for the penetration combinedly called as acrosins. Acrosins are the combinedly enzymes or hormones present in the sperm, meant for penetration and fertilization process. During the fertilization process, these acrosins are responsible for the penetration and fertilization process to continue. And just below the cap region, we see the elongated part where it consists of the chromatin material or chromosomal material meant for fertilization process, that is long, called as nucleus containing chromosomal material. So in this, the 23 set of chromosomes are present in this, which are generally coming from the male parent to the baby. So this will be containing the chromosomal material, and this chromosomal material is present in the nucleus. The nucleus is present below the acrosome. And the sperm is completely outlined with a plasma membrane. The sperm is completely on the outer part, like our skin, which is located completely covering our body. The complete sperm is covered by a membrane called as plasma membrane in the case of this sperm. And When you come below this, you can see that the next part called as a middle piece. The middle piece. This middle piece consists of mitochondria. They are generally approximately near to 50 mitochondria in each sperm cell. Already we have discussed that mitochondria is called as the powerhouse of the cell, and this mitochondria generate the energy requirement. Already we have discussed that in the previous topic. Mitochondria generate the power required for the sperm cell during the movement or motility. So here the mitochondria are present in the neck region. The mitochondria are present in the neck region, and this is giving the energy. So it is also called as the energy source of the sperm. And to the neck middle piece region, a long elongated tail is also present. This tail is helpful for the movement of sperm after maturation inside the male reproductive system and entering into the female vagina. From vagina to the ampullary isthmic junction for the movement of the sperm for the particular direction this tail is needed. So tail makes the sperm motile or movement. This is very important. Riemann's diagram or sometimes Feynman's with explanation. So here this diagram is meant for 3 marks or generally for 5 marks in the case of the examination with explanation. Once again, come back. So sperm is basically categorized into 3 parts. First part, head region. Head consists of acrosome, and below the acrosome, the cap-like structure, we can see that nucleus is elongated. Nucleus is present in the head region. This consists of chromosomal material. This chromosomal material helps in the fertilization process and to form the zygote, and this consists of the father's 23 set of chromosomes which are going to be inherited to the baby. So father's one, that is N condition, that is haploid condition nucleus, means 23 set of chromosomes are set, not a pair, not pair only set. The 23 set of chromosomes are going to be present in this nucleus, and these will be deciding the baby whether they are going to be a born male or female baby. So here, just below this sperm, you can see that middle piece region. This middle piece region only consists of mitochondrial matrix or mitochondria embedded in this. This mitochondria, already you know that it is the powerhouse of the cell, and this is the energy source for the sperm to swim inside after maturation inside the body of the male reproductive system as well as in the female reproductive system. So this middle piece region, we can see a tall, long, elongated tail is also present. Generally, tail will be more than the head as well as the middle piece of this sperm. Means, based on the length of the tail, generally the morphological analysis of this semen sperm is done. So the long the tail, the long the motility, the more the motility. And tail is meant for swimming in the male reproductive system and in also the female reproductive system, that is in the vagina as well as uterus, ampullary isthmic junction, and so on. And now coming on to this This is the anatomical structure coming on to the characteristic features of this sperm. Characteristic features of this particular sperm. We can see that generally these sperms are microscopic in nature. Sperms are microscopic in nature, and they generally per time they will be released 200 to 300 million number of sperms. 200 to 300 million number of sperms. The sperm cells are generally motile in nature, and approximately from this number of cells, 60% of the sperms, six out of the total number of cells, 60% of the sperm cell should be motile. That is, they are capable of moving. And generally from this, 40% should be active. Of these cells should be active, then only there is a possibility of fertilization process. Then only the possibility of fertilization. And these are supported with the semen. Already we have discussed that the semen consists of fructose, phosphates, certain enzymes, and calcium. Along with these components, they also get the secretions from the testosterone, interstitial cells or leading cells produces the testosterone. These androgens are also added to the semen. These leading cells, androgens are also added to the semen, which are, the sperm is maintained by this androgen, that is the testosterone hormone. That is the testosterone hormone. You can see that the semen will be also, along with that, the secretions from the prostate gland, that is prostaglandins, and also from the Cowper secretions or bulbourethral secretions, that is the bulbourethral gland secretions, also called as Cowper secretions, and also the secretions from the seminal vesicles. The secretions from the seminal vesicles, as a result of these, the sperm is maintained and it will be ejaculated out through the male reproductive system to the ejaculatory duct. And when it comes to the female ovum, so hope you understand. We talk with the female ovum structure. So, if you see a matured ovum, a structure of a matured ovum, the matured ovum is generally ovum or ova. Matured ovum or matured ova is generally having the, it is non-motile, means no movement, no movement or non-motile in nature, and these are generally macroscopic. Macroscopic, comparatively bigger than sperm. Macroscopic and generally in the healthy females, it is only one particular ovum per month. Only one particular ovum per month. And you can also see that it is composed of several layers. Several layers. We'll talk why, how they are formed, when they are formed, how that all in the oogenesis process. But try to understand only here that ovum consists of here three layers, a matured, ruptured, matured and released ovum consists of only three layers. So the first, the main ovum is embedded between the different spaces and as well as the different cells surrounding it. So the main ovum is surrounded by the plasma membrane. Comparatively, it is macroscopic, and also you can see that a nucleus is present. This nucleus consists of one set of chromosomes, and just above the plasma membrane, which is indicated with violet color here, the space is called as pre-vitelline space. And just above the pre-vitelline space, you can see that a layer is formed after maturation called as zona pellucida. And just above the zona pellucida layer, a layer of cells which are unevenly, unequally distributed, called as corona radiating cells. These corona radiating cells are helping the ovum to till the implantation and after the implantation. So we'll discuss that. But now remember that ovum is a non-motile, that is no movement, and it is macroscopic, comparatively more than the size of this. Because of its size, it will not move, and it is comparatively bigger than the sperm. And you can also see that it only generally in the female, adult healthy women, you can see that one ovum is released per 1 month, that is one menstrual cycle. And you can see that these layers are useful for the after, before fertilization, during fertilization, and after fertilization till the embryo growth. Till that the zona, corona radiating cells as well as the zona pellucida layer will be supporting the ovum for further process. So, here, We'll discuss the next part in the next Oogenesis.